Morning, guys. Y'all doing okay today? Beautiful. Well, welcome to church. My name is Ryan. I'm a part of our staff team here at The Rock. And as you heard in the video, our lead pastors, Pastor Kirk and Pastor Suzette, are away this weekend ministering to our great friends in Kansas City. But today, we have something really special, a really special treat for you guys. Over the last several weeks, we've been in a series called The Blessed Life. Somebody say, The Blessed Life. The Blessed Life. Pastor's been teaching these messages. I know if you're like me, you've been really getting a lot out of it. And we've had our staff team telling stories over the last several weeks as well. And as we close the series out today, we thought, what better way to close out this series than to hear some stories from our church family? You guys up for that today? Awesome. Help me welcome our panel today. Three incredible folks in our church. So help us get to know you guys. Maybe introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about you, how you came to be at the church, what you're involved with, a little bit of your history. So we'll start with you.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm happy to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
I'm happy to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
All right. My name is Kayola Smallwood. I have been in Asheville for almost 2 years now, since February 2014. I moved here from New York, although I am a North Carolina girl. I was born in Lumberton. My family still lives on the East Coast. My father was a pastor. So I was born and raised in the church, and sometimes that was almost literal. I am grateful to be a part of this body because it is a nurturing and loving body. I love being here. I volunteer in the youth services here. I love working with Pastor Chris and Miss Lisa. I work in Our Nation Middle School and Our Nation High School on Wednesday night. I love the leadership in this church. All I ever get from them is encouragement, which is why I belong here. We came to be here because Lynn Bosa found us a house. And we asked her to give us the name of five churches, but she invited us here and never gave us the other four names. Because she knew we belonged here, and for that, I am grateful.
Awesome.
Morning, everybody. My name is Pete Perez, the one of six kids that my mother's in heaven for raising, six crazy kids. Grew up in the Chicagoland area, had a career where I was in human resources at the executive level, mostly working for food companies. Retired about 6 years ago and came down to Asheville. I got to tell you, with 12 inches of snow on the ground in Chicago, I'm happy I'm down here right now. Not only in this house, but not under that snow. But Cindy and I were looking for a life-giving church, and we had kind of historical struggles because I grew up Catholic and she grew up Baptist. And we were looking for a real spirit-based progressive church that we could become a part of. Walked in the doors here, and it was just absolutely immediate. The amount of learning and growth I've had being here, the same with Cindy, the involvement we've had, the luxury of being able to serve and the blessing of being able to serve has just been awesome. I work with Celebrate Recovery Ministry. I'm getting ready to go on my fifth mission trip to Nicaragua, part of a team that's leaving in February. And have just developed such a heart for that country. It's just absolutely amazing what God does down there. And work with the leadership staff here at The Rock, and just, this is home. I've had churches I've become close to, but nothing like this house.
Good morning, everyone. I am Vicki Garner, and I also, as Kayla, I was raised in church. I've been raised in church my entire life. My father's also a pastor. I'm fortunate enough that my mom and dad, actually, he retired a couple of years ago, and they also now attend The Rock Church, and I'm so glad that they're here. I've been coming here for about 6 years. I was raised in Asheville, also born in Lumberton, So Kale and I have a lot in common. That's very unusual for two people to be born in Lumberton, North Carolina. So,
God is at work already.
Yes, he is. I have been in the financial world for pretty much my entire career, 24 years, and I am one of those fortunate people that can say I honestly love my job. I enjoy getting up every morning and going to work. That is one thing I feel very blessed to have. And the other blessed thing, I'm just so thankful for this church. Leslie Rickman invited me here 6 years ago, and when I came in, it was pretty much like, Pete, I knew when I walked in the door. The praise and worship, along with the word of God that's spoken here on a regular basis, it spoke to me immediately, and I knew this is where I was supposed to be.
Awesome.
And the other thing we have in common, she is my banker.
Well, I have the distinct privilege of knowing these guys fairly well, and as you can already tell, these are some great people that we have the privilege of hearing from today. I want to jump right into it, though. You know, we've been in this series, The Blessed Life, for several weeks now, and you heard me share a little bit of my story last week. I think God has a giving story. We all have a giving story somewhere where our life collides, and God is teaching us some things about our own habits and thinking. So let's dive into that and maybe share with us your giving story. Vicki, you want to get us started?
Absolutely. Well, of course, you can probably imagine going along with being raised in church. It's always just been part of my life. I've seen my parents give. I was taught at a very young age what it all meant, the tithing part of it, the offering, the giving. And so it was just a natural thing for me to automatically just take over when I started working a job, and understanding that that was part of what I was going to do. It's something that I enjoy doing. I love giving. It's very rewarding. And so it was part of just being inbred into me, and it was just part of our household. It was a part of our heart of what we did, and we enjoyed doing it, bringing and giving our tithes to the house of God.
Yeah, for me, I think it goes beyond tithing and then just how I looked at money growing up. My dad was a cop. There were six kids. My mom didn't work. And I watched them struggle. I watched them get part-time jobs. I watched how they did everything that they could to put it together, and just really worried that there wouldn't be enough. I grew up with the attitude there's not going to be enough, and I got to scramble, and I got to run, and I go after it. And as I get older, I've seen that that was a very will-based approach, but it was one that was born out of fear. As I grew up and started to be able to go to school and earn some money, I always considered myself generous, and Cindy and I always gave. But frankly, I never had teachings on the idea of tithing. I would see it, but people would talk about it in sermons, but it was never really brought home for me. It was actually only being at the Rock that really became clear. I was always clear about the connection between giving and receiving and blessing, but not the idea, the power, that biblical idea of being blessed by how you treat your money, which most of us consider to be the most important thing in our life. And I grew up thinking that was the thing that we probably had the least. We had love, we had prayer, we had other things, but that wasn't there. So really, a lot of the teachings at the Rock have really helped me get a hold of this. And also for me, part of it was growing up in a Catholic church, I would have honestly a big distrust, seeing all the assets the church had, how asset intensive it was. It kind of looked like a corporation to me. It didn't have the feeling. It was hard for me to see where the money went, like it is in this church and a local church and what it is that we do. So giving's always been important to me and being blessed by it, but the idea of tithing is relatively new to me.
Well, like Vicki, I was born and raised in the church, so I was taught to tithe at home. I've always been a tither. And I remember the importance of tithing. My brother once spent his Sunday school money. My husband loves this story. And he bought bubble gum and candy, and I remember my father saying, "You spent the Lord's money?" And he took that bubble gum and candy. I know a lot of you in here are not as old as I am, but the penny candies used to, you go to the store and they put them in the little brown bags. Yes. My father made him put that bubble gum and candy in that brown bag and take it to church and dump it in the offering plate. So this was something I was never going to get caught out there. I'm not spending my Sunday school money. That taught me right there as a child that you don't spend the Lord's money. But I was listening to a pastor on TV who took it to a whole nother level. The tithing is what I owe God, and God sees my heart in what I give above my tithe. And I honestly and truly do believe, I have always believed this from a child, that giving is one of my spiritual gifts. I hold everything loosely in my hand because it doesn't belong to me. And I get joy out of blessing other people and seeing other people smile. It's worth the money to see somebody smile. When you spent 31 years in education in New York City, it's not about money. You're not going to get rich in education. Hello, teachers. You're not going to get rich in education unless you're the chancellor or a crook, and I was neither one of those. So I enjoy giving it away because I know God is using me as a conduit. If I give it away, he's going to give more, right? So I'll have it to give away, right? And it's always there.
Amen. Good. Awesome. Hey, give it up for our guys here. One of the aspects of my story that I was sharing last week was that even though I grew up in church, grew up with parents who loved Jesus, when it came time for me to actually step up to the plate and give of my own hard-earned money, it was a challenge for me. I wrestled with it, and eventually God won, and I have been so blessed since. So maybe let's talk about the wrestling aspect. Does anybody have a story where you were struggling with this concept, either in a moment or over a season where God was just challenging you on giving? Does anybody want to share a story on that?
Yeah, sure, I'll go. Even though, I mean, like I said, I grew up in church and I've always give, I went through a period of time pretty much right when I first started coming here and just had struggled with just some financial situations that I was faced with that was pretty much out of my control. And so I felt, or I reasoned in my mind, and it's so funny how we can just reason, we try to reason with God, which really we're not, we're just tricking ourselves. But I was trying to reason, okay, well, I can maybe get away with it not doing it this week, and I'll do it the next time, or not do it this pay period, but I'll do it the next time. And I did that several times, and I felt so convicted. I didn't feel condemned because I know God gives grace and mercy. And so I know that he loves me and he understands where we're at, where we're in a season where we may be questioning, we may be trying to do those reasonings in our head. But in my heart, I knew that this was something that I needed to get back to because it felt like I was struggling. Even though I didn't pay the tithes, I still felt like I was struggling and still would just come up short or just felt like I didn't have enough. And then when I got back on track with that, there's always enough. And that's one thing. I grew up in my household with my parents. We never went without. We never lacked anything. I don't ever remember us needing anything. We always had what was needed. And God just brought that back to my memory. I had to just get back to that, to the basics, to my foundation of knowing what was the right thing to do. And I've been tremendously blessed because of it.
Yeah, for me, the struggles I've had around this concept, honestly, have been in this church. Since I was never taught about tithing growing up, I was confronted by it by coming into this church and hearing a lot of PK's teachings. And I was pretty rebellious about it in my heart. I've always had a giving heart. I always knew that God had touched me through this church, and I wanted to touch other people and to be able to invest so that they could be touched. So that part I had down. but it felt like I was being poked at. Like I was like, you know, you're not the boss of me kind of thing, you know. And I had that heart and just kept praying through it. And God's kind of led me through a couple steps. One of them is knowing and realizing that I look at like a Jim and Sherry Puffer that have been here for a long time and all they've invested in, and that I wouldn't have been able to be touched and this wouldn't be the same place without what it is people like them have done, and that I have that same responsibility. I have that fire that I want. Asheville's so in need of being touched that I want other people to feel what it is that we've all felt, and just continue to expand. But what I didn't get was the idea of tithing. It felt like a rule. It felt like a law. It felt like something, this is what you're supposed to do. And anytime I'd heard it in the past, it felt more like a fundraising drive than it did some biblical teaching that was brought to me. And I never understood as well as I do now, the part of it is, it's a blessing unto you. Forget about the giving and what it is you're doing for the next generation. That I've got that around prayer, and I've got that around reading in the Bible. I've got that around serving, but somehow I never connected it around money, which for most of us, and given my history, was probably the most important thing that I clung on to the most, that it is a vehicle for blessing. It's way over and above what it is that you're giving.
You know, I think recognizing where you have those challenging moments is important. And so let's turn that around a little bit right now. And what would you have to say to an individual or a family who they themselves are struggling with this idea? Maybe they've never been taught this idea before. Maybe it's just that particular season that they're in. What would you say to a family, an individual that's maybe wrestling with that idea of tithing, the idea of giving?
I would encourage them to try it. You don't know if you can do something until you try it. And you'll find that you'll have more than your share, you know, because tithing opens up the door for God to protect what we have and to prevent the devourer from taking what we have. And I've seen it in my life, my entire life. You know, my husband and I in 2006 went to the Dominican Republic on our second trip. And we met this young man on the beach who was selling timeshares for Lake Grove Vacation Club. And I said to Larry, nobody's gonna buy from him. Look at his shirt. I mean, his shirt was filthy, you know. And he would watch us every day, and he finally got the nerve to come over and ask us for money. And I said to Larry, he said, I'm gonna give him $20. And I said, we should give him $40, we can afford that. I mean, you're on vacation, you're spending extravagantly. A stranger would not come and ask you for money if they didn't need money. So this man comes back the next day and he said, my family had meat last night, chicken, for the first time in over 3 years. And I was immediately convicted, you know, because we take everything for granted because we have. They don't have. And we adopted that family. And to this very day, you know, we sent them $300 a month, every month since July of 2006. And when the earthquake came to Haiti and the rice prices went up, we increased it to $350 a month. And we go the first of the month to a Western Union and wire that money. If you don't wire it on the first, he's on the phone on the second, because they really need that money. You know, we went on a tour while we were there, and our tour guide said that a family of four can live comfortably in the Dominican Republic on $350 a month. And he said, well, and a family in Haiti lives on one-tenth of that. Now, I was an English teacher, so math was not my strong suit. But you don't have to be a mathematician to know that they live on $35 a month, which is terrible, you know. And you give, we have never been so we couldn't send the money that they need. We always said, if we don't have, make sure these people get that money on the first of every month. And we do that on the first of every month. It hasn't stopped me from giving to the several ministries that I give outside of this church. It has never stopped me from tithing in this church. It has never stopped me from participating, I mean, generously in Kingdom Builders and now Endeavor. It's not my money. It all belongs to the Lord. I am happy that He has chosen me as a conduit steward to filter things through to other people. I'm grateful for that.
Anybody else, what would you have to say to a family individual that's maybe wrestling with that idea right now?
I think for me, I've got some real strong feelings about this, and I think I'd be telling them, I get your struggle. I get how it feels. I know the confusion around it. I know the buttons it pushes. I know a lot of us have been given false teachings about this over time, and that, you know, a lot of America is built up into taking money one way or another, from big banks to all kinds of organizations, and we're used to holding a healthy amount of distrust about that. And I know for me anyway, when PK started leaning into these preachings, when you've got an area of your life you don't really understand God in, it frustrates you at first. It makes you want to back away. It feels like pain. And my advice would be, keep open. You just may be missing a blessing. Don't lock out. I wouldn't advise you just jump whole in, because you won't do it if your heart's not there. But don't lock it out and walk away, because that message causes you pain. Because I do believe there was real power in this and the teaching and understandings of this.
Amen. Good, Pete. I would agree with Pete. I see it on a daily basis. Money, there's just, that's one thing you don't mess with, people's money. It seems to be very, they hold it. They want to hold it and they want to keep it because they don't trust a lot of things. And I see it working in the financial world on a regular basis. So I would say to anyone that's struggling or really trying to reason in their head, pray about it. That would be, just pray and seek God yourself. I mean, these teachings have been phenomenal. Even for someone that's been in church your whole life, it's still, you need that repetitive reminding of God's word, and you need to have it just built and just keep pushing it down into your spirit, into your heart. But pray about it. If you're sitting here saying, I really don't understand, I'm one of those that don't, I just don't get it, and it's my money, it's my money. It's really not. Everything that you have is comes from God, and He wants to bless you abundantly. But I would say He doesn't want you to live in confusion. He doesn't want you to be confused, and He doesn't want you to give just out of a bad place. He wants you to understand, and so I would just pray and seek God and just search it out for yourself, because that's what the Word of God is there for, and He'll open your eyes of understanding, and just pray that the Holy Spirit give you that understanding of what it's all about.
Yep. Awesome. Good stuff. You know, I think, awesome. I think that when we look at what the Word of God says when it relates to tithing specifically, God puts it in His Word that if we honor Him with that, that He does two things, that He will provide for us, that He sends us blessing, and that He will protect us. He rebukes the devourer. That's what the Bible says. So my question to you guys is, in your life, as you have given, trusted God with your tithe, with your finances, have you seen Him work specifically in that way, where He's provided in a specific way or protected you in a specific way?
Yeah, I'll share a little bit about my story. When I came here to the church, I was going through a divorce, and so I had to sell our home, and so I was renting, and I felt like at this age in my life, I felt like, okay, God, I don't really own anything. I don't have anything of my own, and it's a bad place to feel. It's just sometimes it's a hard place to feel like you've worked so hard your entire life, and now you're left with really sort of you feel like nothing. And I came into this place, and that was the time I was going through the struggle of trying to reason to hang on to some things. But when I became faithful, and I'm just happy to say, long story short, God has restored to me. I now own a home. I'm blessed abundantly. And it's just amazing what God will do. He will restore what the enemy takes from you.
Yeah, for me, it's kind of a before and after. You know, I'm a believer that sometimes you got to see the dark before you can see the light. And I know, having grown up poor and scratching, once I got to the point that I was able to make some decent money and have a decent bank account, somehow I thought it was all magically going to make me happy. And I just saw a lot of anxiety and pain, and it just never got better. It's just, it never fills that hole. And for me, one of the things that has happened since I really leaned into this, and it's hard for me to separate what's tithing and what's serving and what's praying and what's being in the Bible. I just know if I pull my foot off the gas on any one of those, my life isn't near as blessed, my life isn't near as clear. And it's shown up for me in a non-financial way. It's shown up in just the restoration of my family, in a marriage that Cindy and I had that was just falling apart after years of running like crazy and not putting enough energy into her and the kids, and my daughter now being down here living in the same place, us praying together, us believing in God, leaning into that, and just the restoration that he's given me.
Oh, that's great. Thank you for sharing that, Pete. One of the things that we talked about when we started the series, Pastor was talking about how you know, depending on what kind of filter you have on, and we all have some kind of filter, right? You may hear different things as we talk about this series, and it may sound like this is all about money and all about finances, but ultimately, what I think this is all about is what Pastor was teaching us a few weeks ago, that it really is a heart issue, and that the Bible teaches us that everything flows out of our heart. So maybe respond to that this is really a heart issue, not a money issue.
Well, I really do believe it's a heart issue. I said before that I believe that giving is my spiritual gift. It is one of my spiritual gifts. I hold stuff loosely in my hand. It isn't mine. If it makes somebody else happy, then I'm happy. That's the way I live my life, you know. You can't take it with you, you know. I've gone to a lot of funerals, and there are no U-Hauls or Brinks trucks in the processional, so you're not taking it with you, you know. If you bless somebody with it, that same person will run up to you and hug you in heaven. You know, that's what they say. All the sowing that you do here, people are going to run up and hug you in heaven that you don't even know, because what you sowed here made the quality of their life better. And that's what we're all about, is building God's kingdom. You know, that's what I want to be a part of.
Yeah, I think for me, being able to look back at some of the things I've seen in life, in human resources, you're responsible for compensation. So I saw a lot of executives and how they behaved around money and what ended up happening with them. And one company I worked with, we had traders, commodities traders, that were literally making $20 to $25 million a year. And I would watch people, how they just became, it was never enough. That extra dollar, that extra piece of payment for their medical plan, it would just never, ever stop. And I would watch the pain that they were in, and I would watch the angst that they had, and they would fill that hole with, you know, sex or cocaine or drinking or whatever. But they would walk around in a knot. I saw this. I lived with these people for decades. And then what blew my mind completely, which is why I have so much heart for it, is the first time I went to Nicaragua. And there's these kids and families that have nothing, that are living in tin shacks, and they were all heart, and all they wanted to do was offer us their food, their ideas, bring us into their home, and they were happy. And I walked away from that thinking, wow, we got it all wrong about how we look at happiness in the world. And they were just living examples of what it means to give it away and not hold it.
That's really good, Pete. That's fantastic. So for my final question here to you guys, it involves a little bit of imagination and time travel. I think about who I was when I was 18 years old and who I am today. And you should be very glad that I am not that 18-year-old guy anymore. And I don't know if you guys have changed at all since you were 18. I know I sure have. God has changed my life in tremendous ways. So my question is, if you could go back and talk to your 18-year-old self and maybe give them some advice specifically about finances or giving in general, what would you say to them, Vicky?
So just tell them about tithes, not everything.
Yeah, we don't have enough time for the full gamut of life advice, because
I could take that up myself. I tell my 18-year-old self. Yeah. That could take another service. I think what I would just reinforce everything I had been taught, but I think that I would just tell myself to pray for wisdom and being sure to be a good steward of what God gives me, because it's so important. Money can be very wasteful. You can be very wasteful. And so I think that even though I was a giver and I have been, I think I would tell myself to be a better steward and to look at what is really important. It's been brought for so much. It's not in all materialistic things. And so I love giving to the house of God so that people like Pete can go. I've been overseas into a mission field, and I can honestly say I would rather give money so people can go. So, but I've seen how blessed we are. So I would just tell myself as an 18-year-old to be a better steward and to really look at what's the most important in giving.
I think for me, probably the first thing I'd have to say to my 18-year-old self is put that in a joint and that beer. I got something important to talk to you about. I think what I would say to myself at that age is, I know you're scared. I know you're scared of being poor. I know you're scared you're not going to get out of this neighborhood. I know you're scared this isn't all going to work out for you. And you're going to run a lot of risk as you go ahead and try and build a life for yourself. If you try to do this on your own, you're going to have a lot of pain in front of you. And it isn't going to work out the way you thought it would. You're going to have money and you're going to be unhappy. And it's going to be important for you to understand that if you approach your life out of your own will and not out of where God's guiding you, that it's all going to fall apart for you. But that if you do it and trust in Him, He'll provide everything for you, your love, your family, your financial situation, that He will take care of you.
Well, I think I would tell my 18-year-old self, when I was 18, I was in my freshman year at Livingstone College in Salisbury. So I would tell my 18-year-old self to be as generous as I am now, because there, you know, I would do my tithe to the penny. You know, it's like I needed my money to go to the canteen with my friends and all that kind of stuff. I would be a lot more generous than I was at 18 years old. I mean, you don't have a lot at 18. I certainly didn't, you know, a freshman in college. But I would tell myself to be as generous as I am now, because now I recognize that my tithe is what I owe God. I would have given more, and I probably would have been blessed more if I had gone above the tithe. But see, age, you learn with age. I'm grateful for that.
Awesome, beautiful. Well, hey, I know I really enjoyed these guys. Can we give it up for our panel today? They've been fantastic. You know, I absolutely love hearing stories like this. I love hearing stories of God's faithfulness, stories of God's love, His provision, the way He always looks after us. And And we've been in this series and closing it out today. We've been in it for a few weeks now. And wherever you are with this, we just want to say that we know that God is writing a story in your life. He's writing a story of goodness, of blessing, of faithfulness. And maybe you're in a chapter right now that looks great. It looks awesome. That's fantastic. But maybe you're in a chapter right now that's kind of tough. Can I just say that it is just a chapter, and that God is writing a big, big story in each and every one of our lives. And I love walking out these stories with you, with our church family, with these guys. I think it's a beautiful thing. Amen? Well, as we close out today and close out this series, can I pray with you today? Can we pray together? Let's do that. Father, we are coming to you today so incredibly grateful for who you are. Father, for the God that you are. You are a big, generous, good God who loves to bless. Father, it is your heart to bless your children, Father, so much so that you gave your only son, Jesus. Lord, I'm praying for every single person in this room. Father, every single person that has even heard any of the messages from this series. Lord, we are asking you to pour out your blessing on us. Father, that the windows of heaven would open up over our lives. Lord, we're trusting in your word. We're believing what your word says, which is if we honor you, Father, you will pour out your blessing on us. If we honor you, Father, you will protect us from the devourer. So God, we're entrusting our lives. We're entrusting our heart to you. And Father, we speak a special blessing over our church now. Lord, and right now, with all eyes closed, all heads are bowed, we want to give you an opportunity this morning to receive Jesus. We've been talking about the blessed life here for several weeks. Pastor's been teaching on it. But really, the very first step in walking out a blessed life is to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, to make Jesus the Lord of your life. So this morning, all eyes are closed, all heads are bowed. We're not going to do anything to embarrass you this morning, but I do want to give you an opportunity this morning that maybe you're in a spot where you'd say, I've never given my life to Jesus. Or maybe you used to be close to God and you're not right now. Or maybe you're just not sure where you stand, but you want to be sure. All over this room, if you're in any of those spots, will you just raise your hand right now just to signal to me, Ryan, pray with me. I want to make Jesus the Lord of my life. Awesome. Thank you. All over the room, today is your day. It's a brand new start, a brand new day. I want to give you this moment to just let me pray with you to make Jesus number one in your life. Is there anybody else who wants to make that decision today? Beautiful. Well, this is for those of us who raised our hands, but let's all pray this out loud together. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm coming to you today and to your cross where you paid the price for all of my sin. Lord Jesus, today's a fresh start. It's a new beginning. Help me live the blessed life and become the person you've created me to be. Amen. Amen.